Corey, first of all, welcome to London, Ontario.
Well, thank you so much. Hi, Andy. Hi, Pam.
Good morning.
The phone lines are still lighting up, and we may throw in the odd caller, but let me ask you, Mr. Hunt, what, you know, you put together this documentary, you wrote it, you directed it, The Perfect Human Diet. Does The Perfect Human Diet include an Egg McMuffin with no yolk?
Well, no, it might work out if it hadn't won. It certainly doesn't include having no yolk. In fact, I mean, we'll probably cover it during the discussion. And Pam mentioned that if you didn't have cholesterol that was in the egg, we wouldn't have the brain power to fuss about this. You know, it's that the cholesterol in the bones of animals that we ate over 2.5 million years is what made us who we are. It made us the dominant species on the planet. And once we started changing our food sources, which would include avoiding now in our modern age, trying to avoid cholesterol and fats, we go downhill rapidly. You know, it's an unfortunate political reflection in both your country and my country that these kinds of decisions are not made on the most accurate or most recent science. They're made on the political support of the current food system, which is heavily grain-based.
Okay, let me ask both of you. Pam first. Why would McDonald's do this? I mean, who got to them?
Well, essentially, it has a lot to do with the food lobbyists and this pervasive lie that has been coming out of groups like the USDA and Health Canada, our universities, and even the media, that somehow cholesterol and animal fat have joined the dark side. So they want to keep this lie persistent in the media, as they want to keep people afraid of animal fat, because what it does is it actually increases the sale of things like edible oils. It increases the sale of statin drugs, for example. Companies like Pfizer would benefit from it. I mean, there's a huge spin-off in terms of perpetuating this lie about the demonization around animal fats.
CJ, why?
Why the politics or why
no,
the demonization?
No, why did McDonald's make this decision to take the egg yolk out of their Egg McMuffin? Who got to them? What's the logic?
Well, I think it's politically expedient because the obesity epidemic has become such a crisis here and in your country, and it's out of control. It's a firestorm. They really don't know what to do, and the only things that their steps they're willing to take are the ones that are the most expeditious and are the least harmful to their, you know, the food sources that they use, I think, you know.
I think a lot of it, too, CJ, is that if they blame cholesterol for this obesity epidemic, then we take our eye off the target, which is really grain, sugar, you know, highly refined foods and so on.
Right. Even Andrew Weil down here, or Weil, I never do say his name right, I'm sorry. But he's well-known for 8 weeks to optimal health and all that. He's very big on near vegetarianism and whatnot, recently came out, and he's in our film, saying fats do not make you fat. It's the refined carbohydrates and the highly refined sugars that are driving the obesity epidemic. So when you get, you know, the old school switching over and saying, well, wait a second, the science doesn't support this, and we're getting it all wrong, you would hope someone would end up and pay attention.
Okay, so let me just get your definitive, you know, that 30-second clip you want to hear on the newscast and on the evening news. If ABC News were to ask C.J. Hunt, the writer and director of the documentary The Perfect Human Diet, Mr. Hunt, this is a big decision by McDonald's taking the yolk out of an Egg McMuffin. How do you respond, Mr. Hunt?
Well, I'd say it's time to look at the most recent science, which says that animal fats and proteins are irreplaceable in an optimal human diet. I mean, that's it in a nutshell. And then if they want to go on and ask what that science is, you know, it gets into a longer conversation. But what we discovered in the course of making the film was that, and I didn't expect this at all, it was unexpected to me, is that there is science. There is a radioisotopic analysis where we can tell you exactly what humans ate and become this, you know, the dominant species on the planet. So it's no longer theory, it's fact. And if they're willing to look at the facts of the science, then it would serve them well.
There are some. Pam Colleen has been preaching this message from her bully pulpit right here on News Talk 1290 CJBK. And there are some, I'm going to be very frank, Pam knows this is not a surprise, they think that she's full of bull. And it's not, you know, it's not the prime steak that she's full of. And yet there are so many like you who are saying the perfect human diet involves animal fat. So here's the question. Do you expect that the Pam Colleens and the C.J. Hunts and the many other guests we've had on in this issue represent a constituency large enough so that when we turn on ABC News tonight, there's going to be some blowback to McDonald's decision, or is it going to be all applause?
I suspect that it's all going to be all applause, partially because of the own difficulty I'm having in getting on to the news programs with a investigative, fact-filled documentary that isn't based on opinion. So, you know, in my own experience, it's so far, I can't get anyone to bite. So as far as the population is concerned, I think there might be a lot of grumbling online, you know, amongst the choir. But I don't know that it's enough yet to move
now,
the news.
In your movie, you actually feature somebody who's been on our show, Gary Taubes. He's the author of the book Good Calories, Bad Calories, and another book called Why We Get Fat. And he has joined an effort with a medical doctor to study what you're saying in your movie. What I've been saying on the show along with Andy is that animal fats are our friend, not our enemy. He's got funding from a billionaire hedge fund manager to go ahead and prove essentially that your movie is correct. So I think that there is some effort happening at a grassroots level. I think that the truth is going to come out eventually. But like I said earlier, they hold on to this lie like a dog to a bone. And I don't know what it is in terms of what it's going to take for grassroots to actually rise to the top here.
Well, I think you're right that it is truly a grassroots effort. Because, I mean, we grew up with all of the same misinformation. And it's hard when you've seen it 100,000 times that, you know, grains are good for breakfast and fats are bad for you. And then someone else comes out and says, well, wait a second, we've got that all wrong. People scratch their heads or they rebel. Or it's a very emotional subject. Wait a minute, my mom made me pancakes. Mm-hmm. What are you saying? You know, you know, and instead of, you know, turning to the science to learn something new, a lot of folks just react viscerally. And they say, well, wait, they haven't been lying to me for 30 years. You're not telling the truth.
CJ, so. I want to get into the specifics of the documentary, but before that, I want to ask you your personal story. You're not a nutritionist. You're not a dietitian. You're a journalist, but you have walked through the valley on this issue personally. Can you share that story?
Well, sure. When I was a bike racer, motocross, which may be popular up there as well, when I was 24 years old, I went jogging in recovery from an injury to get back in shape. And I went a lap and a half and I dropped dead. Luckily enough, an anesthesiologist was coming out on Memorial Day 1978 to go jogging himself and started giving me CPR until the paramedics got there. They jump-started me and took me to UCLA Medical Center in Los Angeles, where I spent 10 days in intensive care. So, in my story, it turns out in the long view of it, I've learned that I have a heart birth defect and that it wasn't related to diet. But at the time, nobody knew and nobody could pin down what the problem was. But after that, it certainly drove my interest in health and wellness and for myself. And I read everything I could and I tried it. Everything I could. I was a raw food vegan for over 5 years. I ate nothing but fruits, vegetables, nuts, seeds, and sprouts, all uncooked, mind you. And that seemed to be serving me well, although I had to eat all the time in order to support that. And I did fasting and water fasting and juice fasting and, you know, the whole nine yards. And but then unfortunately, you know, and I really, by the way, as an aside, have a heartfelt feeling for this report of the officer that was killed in an auto accident is my mother was killed by a drunk driver. And we were best friends. And that emotional trauma, I wasn't coming back from. I didn't have the kind of nutritional support to recover emotionally or physically from that. And then eventually I just had this, you know, little inner voice that said, well, eat fish. You need real protein. And, you know, so I reintroduced animal foods back into my diet and quickly got much better. So, yes, I experimented with everything because I'm one of those kind of folks that, well, I need to try this out for myself. And what I would tell myself is it certainly can't be any worse than eating a Jack in the Box, which is a fast food place down here. I don't know if you have it up there.
What's it called again?
Jack in the Box.
Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely.
It's like McDonald's and those kinds of things. And I said, well, it couldn't be any worse for me than that to eat raw foods all the time. But I wasn't right about that either.
Well, CJ, we're coming down to the bottom of the hour. We have to take a news break. Are you able to stay with us for a bit after the other side, after the news? Because I want to ask you specifically what you're suggesting are the stereotypes about what bad food is in the context of this McDonald's decision, which broke literally within the last hour, and then ask you specifics about diets that you would suggest to people when you suggest that they eat what you call the perfect human diet. Back with Pam Colleen and C.J. Hunt with the perfect human diet when we come back in just a moment right here on London Today on News Talk 1290 CJBK.
The fast food giant will offer a yolk-free version of its breakfast sandwich this spring. At 260 calories, the egg white McMuffin is 40 calories less than the regular sandwich. The new offering is part of the chain's response to critics who say fast food chains like McDonald's contribute to rising obesity rates.
Well, if you haven't heard the breaking news this morning, and it is a blockbuster announcement from McDonald's, they're about to take the yolk out of their Egg McMuffin. And it just so happens that Pam Colleen and I have a guest, C.J. Hunt, who is the writer and director of the documentary, The Perfect Human Diet. And as we're talking about The Perfect Human Diet, I'm inviting your call, 643-1290, what you think of McDonald's decision to take the yolk out of their Egg McMuffin. And again, CJ, just before we get to the nitty-gritty of the perfect human diet, in the perfect human diet, would the yolk still be in the Egg McMuffin?
Well, it would. And please let me clarify for you. You're right, I'm a journalist, and I'm not an advocate. What it is that I'm sharing the science from these world-class experts that we discovered in this, what turned out to be a treasure hunt. And we learned things that we never expected to learn about what is an optimal or a perfect human diet. So these are not my personal opinions. This is the science that behind what.
But it's not just science. It's not just science, CJ. What I find is it's based in common sense, isn't it? Because we're looking at history. We're not looking at newfangled diets that may have surfaced in the last 10, 20, 30, 40 years. We're looking at generations that survived on the principles that you outline in your movie.
Well, I think, yeah, that's a good observation. As a journalist, I tend to use the word science all the time. But it's also been shown in ancestral diets that following those principles are much, much healthier than anything we're doing today.
But it's driving our listeners crazy because, you know, Pam often quotes science. You're quoting science. And I'm sure McDonald's would say that it's the science that convinced them to take the yolk out of their Egg McMuffin.
Well, in dirt bike racing, if someone who was an expert started racing with the beginners, we used to call that cherry picking. And so to go out there and win at any cost. And unfortunately, what happens in science often, or in the public use of science, is that people cherry-pick the studies that they think will back up their personal perspective. Now, I think what we're trying to do with the film is bring forth new unknown, formerly unknown scientific discovery so we can elevate the conversation so that everyone can say, hey, look, let's look at the whole field of the science that's available so that we can have all the best information in front of us in order to make good decisions, whether it's personal decisions or whether it's, you know, at the government level.
Okay, so let's get into the perfect human diet. What is the perfect human diet?
Well, here's what's interesting, and I think your listeners will find interesting, is that we went on this treasure hunt, and I was ultimately sent to Europe to a dig site in the south of France where they're digging up Neanderthal bones and human bones and animal bones, and from there to Leipzig, Germany, to the Max Planck Institute of Evolutionary Anthropology, where they've developed a kind of testing, and they can test those bones of humans, Neanderthals, and animals and tell you exactly what they ate. So and what's also possible is you can take the bones of post-agricultural peoples from all over the world and tell you what they ate. And the interesting thing is that when we started eating lots of grains, we declined. Our health declined. We dropped 4 to 6 inches in height. So we got weak and brittle bones. We developed dental caries rotting around the orbits of the eyes. And this is all in the archaeological evidence. But what's really great now is that because of this new radioisotope testing, we can tell you what human foods are, and we can tell you what non-human foods are. And I think that's the distinction, rather than being caught up in the McDonald's controversy or arguing about proteins, fats, and carbohydrates, is that what we ought to be doing is looking at species that they, that's where the answer is, and what made the species healthy and fit and dominant.
Now, there was a transition in our diet after the last ice age, 12,500 years ago. Agriculture was invented around 10,000 years ago. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, CJ, but 12,500 years ago, during our last ice age, I don't think we had greenhouses, right?
No, we didn't.
We couldn't have eaten a lot of plant-based foods.
No, and what was interesting is the scientists were telling me when they analyzed the bones there from Europe, that in Northern Europe, it was primarily animal proteins and fats. I mean, the distinction between humans and Neanderthals was the addition of fish. And they fed very little plant foods, you know, and where plant nitrogen started to replace animal protein in the human diet, that's when we started to decline. And that, you're right, that was about 10,000 years ago. And ever since then, it's become more and more part of the human diet. And of course, our health is.
And you have a great scene in the movie. You have a great scene in the movie where you outline that this 10,000-year period is just a blip in the screen in terms of our evolutionary history.
Well, yeah, we walked down an American football field and used that for the 2.5 million years of human evolution. And when you walk all the way down the field from one goal to the other, you get down to the half-yard line, and that's where agriculture first happens in our human history. And then when you look at modern processed oils and refined sugars and junk food, it's the last fifth of the last inch, the width of a blade of grass. So if you go put your finger down on the goal line on one end and then turn around and look all the way back to the other side, for almost the whole length of that football field, humans ate wild plants and animal food.
Okay, so bottom line, CJ, if we had eaten properly and learned from the lessons of history, how would our bodies be different, and then how would our brains be different?
Well, the Leslie Aiello at the Winogrand Foundation of Anthropology in New York said that before agriculture, her professor told her that that was the high point in human history, and from there it's all gone downhill. And when it comes to our health and well-being, we were bigger and taller and stronger, and you know all of that.
And we had bigger brains too, didn't we, CJ?
Yes. And we have bigger brains, and now we're rolling backwards. we're actually in decline.
We're devolving, I think, is the term, isn't it?
Yeah, it's called de-evolution.
De-evolution.
And, yeah.
Some would jump in and say, "Wait a minute, have you seen the new smartphone? It's unbelievable." Have you checked out Andy's new iPhone? Why didn't the cavemen who ate the meat and the animal fats, if they were so darn smart, why didn't they have an iPhone and a BlackBerry?
Well, you know, it's interesting. I mean, agriculture allowed a lot of people to free up their, you know, it allowed an expansion in population. So then we have lots of extra people. And we're able to then diversify into other kinds of things, whether it's art and music and... And all of that happened and started about 50,000 years ago with the cave paintings and whatnot, and it continued to expand into our modern world and our modern times. And it's not that good things haven't come from the fact that we now have more people. It's just that we've paid a price because we changed the fundamental nutritional principles that made us healthy and strong so we could get to the point to become who we are now. And we're the last surviving human species, by the way. Apparently, there were 22. So we're the last man standing.
CJ, we're almost out of time. I want to ask you this basic question. We have a health crisis in North America. Obesity alone, diabetes, heart disease. There are so many chapters to this horror story. What do you think is at the root of all of these issues which our government seems so helpless to deal with?
Well, I mean, the nutritionally, what's at the root of it is that we're eating the wrong stuff. It's that simple. And if we return to the life way that made us strong and healthy, that kind of nutritional support, we will return to being healthy if you're not too far gone already. You know, it's really quite that simple. And the political powers that be don't necessarily have the same interest that you and I have on an individual level. So I think it really is going to take people learning for themselves and putting it into practice. And then maybe someday there will be enough folks that can, you know, influence their local politicians to take it seriously.
So give me a real specific point with respect just to one of these issues, and that is childhood obesity? Why do we have it? What are we doing wrong?
Well, I mean, the specific thing is it's the same thing. It's where we're feeding ourselves inappropriately. We feed for convenience, you know, anything in a box, anything that comes out of a soda fountain, you know, those kinds of things. Just, you know, give it to the kids. They're hungry. The problem is that makes them even hungrier. You know, it doesn't satisfy their nutritional needs, and then there's a tendency to overeat. And these new modern foods that have never been seen in human history are very addictive. So it takes some real self-discipline initially to break yourselves of the food of the modern world and eat only the foods that are really good for us.
CJ,
and nobody argues with about eating, you know, more healthy fruits and vegetables and healthy meats and those kinds of things. The breaking point is whether or not you should eat grains and sugars for most people.
And those are so new in our diet, and we don't tolerate them. I mean, we're designed to eat animal fat, animal protein, and relatively small amounts of plant-based foods.
CJ, if somebody wants to check out your documentary, where can they do that?
Well, in Canada, if they can go to iTunes Canada, they can look on their local cable station and search by name, The Perfect Human Diet. As of April 1st, it's going to expand into what we call in-demand, and in your neck of the woods, I think it's on-demand, maybe Rogers on-demand, but it'll expand to another 55 million homes and be available there, depending on what cable system they have. So they can get on cable on iTunes. At the moment, the DVD is only available in the USA because of postal rates, but that should be fixed in the next couple of months. And
your website is
easily available. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry?
Your website is theperfecthumandiet.us, correct?
Right, perfecthumandiet.us. If they'd like to see what we're about, if they want to see the trailer, learn more about it, and it can also lead them to the video on demand platforms that carry the film. And nicely enough, it's doing really well. People are very interested. And we hit number one documentary and number one independent film in Canada, as well as the USA.
Oh, congratulations.
Yeah, in early January. You know, I mean, those things fluctuate all the time.
Awesome. We are out of time, CJ. Pam and I,
Thank you, sir.
The show, are going out to grab one of the traditional Egg McMuffins before they yank the yolk out of them. And we thank you for joining us this morning.
Well, just eat the egg and throw away the bun, and you'll be great.
That's right.
Okay, so there
you
we go.
Too.
Throw away the bun. Okay, thanks, CJ. I appreciate it.